what's up? This is Trill OG, Bum B, with UGK for life. You're now tuned in to Sports Rap, Lilla Live, baby. Now on Sports Talk 790 AM.
That's right. We are here on Sports Talk 790 AM radio if you're riding around Houston. But if you're around the world, you want to tune in, you get the iHeartRadio app and tune in to your zip code right here in Houston, Sports Talk 790. And you can hear us wherever you are on your Android, BlackBerry, iPhone. It don't matter. Plug it in and join the movement right here on Sports Rap Live. Right now, it's time to open up the rap sheet brought to you by Houston's original sneakerhead destination. That is Active Athlete. And they are getting ready to open their brand new location right there, 59 South. If you head out towards Sugarland, head out towards Northwest, be right there. Yeah, it's about time they made it to the Southwest.
Yes, sir, it is.
I mean, all these kids, you know, we're driving in the hood to get your sneakers. Now come to our hood to pick up your sneakers.
That's why I come down to Ailey's, Mo City, Stafford. Well, I don't know if I call Stafford a hood.
No, not the hood.
It's a hood.
That's my hood. That's not
my hood. It's a sneaker hood. It's down there, it's all sneaker hood.
Absolutely. Well, all the way over there to Highland Park. Well, let me screw up. But you see these grind decks right here, you can pick one of those up at Southside if you keep going south on 59. So
yeah,
head down there, check it out, man.
Well, yeah, we saw a big O out there at the Zulu's Couch Tour from
sure
Southside.
Yeah, so absolutely.
Shout out to DGK, Dirty Ghetto Kids, who threw it down out there at Kenny Mills Mall for the Zumi's Couch Tour skateboarding demo. That was a pleasure to watch. And while we're speaking of skateboarding, shout out to Nyjah Houston for once again winning a street league this weekend. Wow.
Wow. What did Bun call him? Bun, what'd you call Nyjah Houston? You called him the Michael Jordan of skateboarding?
I mean, Michael Jordan of street league.
Absolutely.
Initially, I was thinking of Michael Jordan, but I think it might be closer to Tiger Woods. Because he's killing the money game right now.
Oh, he is.
That's what it is. He's killing the money game right now. He's not Jordan until he gets that Diamond Supply collab line that we were talking about.
Ooh.
You know, once he gets his version of Grizzly Grip Tape, then he'll be on some he'll be on that Jordan level. But right now, he's definitely, you know, as far as his dominance of the sport, I think the fact with Street League being an entirely new league in the sport and him dominating the league with just incredible play, I think he's really helping to put Street League out there.
Is that good or bad? Let me ask you this. Is it good for one guy? Like, it was good for golf, right?
It was good for basketball. You know, it's good for any sport if it helps people respect the sport more. And I think that's what Nyjah's bringing, is just real street skating to, you know, a lot of people that normally would not be supporting it right now. You have your X Games crowd and you have your Street League crowd, and I think that he's helping to bridge the gap.
And you also have the Maloof Money Cup skateboarding tournament thrown by the Maloofs, who also own the Sacramento Kings and the Palms Casino.
Yeah, which is always an incredible event. I think it's like a $1 million event.
Oh, yeah.
That they put together. And, you know, shout out to the Maloofs for just supporting sports as a whole. You know what I'm saying? Trying to get comp some sweets right now. Don't make that face, Andrew.
Hey, but their dealings with the Kings, let's just say,
I'm trying to get comped in Vegas.
Well, how about their business in Vegas has been very good. So, basketball
Andrew,
in Vegas are a little bit.
Andrew, put the mic down.
Thank you.
Like my mom said, if you don't have anything nice to say, whisper. But since we're on the radio, I just won't speak.
You're about to mess up the money, Andrew. Slow it down.
For those of you unfamiliar with Street League, it is a brand new skateboarding contest, you know, thrown by Rob Dyrdek of MTV fame. And they just started this year's event. The first one was in Kansas City, which Nyjah Houston won. And this weekend's was in Ontario, California, which Nyjah Houston won another $150,000 for taking first place.
Not bad.
I mean, he's racking it in right now.
While wearing Diamond Supply.
That's right.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. All right, well, let's get into the guys doing it like Michael Jordan, and that's on the hardwoods as we open up the rap sheet. And Bud B, of course, who is in attendance to experience what some have called the loudest arena in the sport now.
Loco.
We've got to get your experience. First of all, props to the OG for bringing the official conference championship, Western Conference champion, caps, t-shirts from Oklahoma City, where you got to experience it all firsthand for their first finals game.
And we'll get those up on the Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook for all our fans out there tuning in.
No doubt.
No, it was an incredible experience. First of all, shout out to everybody in Loud City, a.k.a. Oklahoma City.
Oh, now they're Loud City now?
Yeah, I mean, they call themselves Loud City, and they take it very serious, you know. Shout out to all the people standing outside, you know, Chesapeake Energy Arena and Thunder Alley. I've never felt more welcome in the city in my life, first of all. I mean, the people in the arena, the people in the city, everybody in OKC made me feel like I was a hometown kid. You know, they showed so much love, you know, at the games, around the city. You know, there was a lot of talk about Lil Wayne having his issues with the people. And, yeah, I guess, you know, there's always one rotten apple that can spoil the bunch. Not Lil Wayne. I'm talking about the person that didn't want to let him in.
Of course. That's exactly what we were talking about.
Don't get that.
I was like,
no! There you guys go. We're not bad rapping right now.
No, that's the...
No Drake Chris Brown going
on. Shout-outs to Lil Wayne for being in Oklahoma City.
Yeah, exactly. And all things considered, man, it was a great experience. Great games to watch. Game one was a great game. Game two was an incredible game. You know, as you sat there and stayed down to the wire, it was an incredible, incredible game. We could, you know, get to arguing, officiating, and all of that kind of thing right now. But if I could say one thing about everything, it's Oklahoma needs to learn how to shoot free throws right now. That's been the issue that I've seen in the games is that, you know, in game one and game two, they missed a lot of crucial free throws that really would have covered the gap of whatever, you know, loss they would have sustained.
I think coming out flat in the first quarter was a bigger issue for Oklahoma City, especially in game two. Well, I mean, at one point, they were 1-for-12 in the first quarter, and that's terrible. That's like AAU-style ball.
We were here for Game 2 live at Junction Bar and Grill every Thursday night, 8 to 10 p.m. on Sports Talk 790.
Yeah, we're listening to Sports Talk Live. They had many opportunities to make up for a lot of those points. I mean, that's a coaching issue. You know what I'm saying? I can understand the coaching issue, but once the ball gets in the player's hands, they got to execute plays. And these guys, you know, free throw is just a player and the ball. There's no other elements other than a few blow-up balloons in there. But there was a home game. They were home games, so they had no excuse to be missing free throws. I was very, you know, and I mean, I'm sure Andrew would love to get into Russell Westbrook and his erraticness or whatever. But
that's pretty funny because it's next on my list. So let's talk about coaching, and then we'll go to Westbrook.
Well, I mean, aside from the coaching, I'm mostly worried about why are the Thunder getting down to these, sort of digging themselves these holes in the first half of games. And the last two times they did, they were at home. I mean, the first time they were able to dig themselves out and they kind of just basically ran away with the first game. But the second game, you have to now question, this is two games in a row that we got ourselves down early, and it seemed like in the second half, if they could just get it to a tie game, they were going to run away with it. But if they could just never get over the hump, they were just always behind, always nipping at their heels. And I was pretty angry with the officiating at the end of the game. I'm not saying that the call should have been an automatic foul call. I just felt like at the end of that play, that was a clear foul. He got fouled twice. He got fouled on his leg, Kevin Durant I'm talking about, and he got fouled when he went for the shot. And also on top of that, LeBron played pretty bad defense down the stretch.
Yeah,
like if you watched him, he actually, the reason that Kevin Durant even had that look is because he really wasn't playing him as well as he could have. He kind of was aloof, not even alert as to where the ball was coming in on the inbound play. So, I mean, I guess I would say the Heat deserved to win that game. They played a much better game throughout the course of that, but for the full four quarters. But if I really have concerns about why Oklahoma City is getting down to these early deficits, I would say, and allowing themselves thinking, because if they get lulled to sleep thinking, oh, we can come back, it's not going to happen like that when they're going to play three games on the road now.
You got these guys that like to think that, you know, they play better under pressure, but you don't want to put yourself in that kind of a position. You know, if you can get out there and get an early lead, man, that's what you want to do, point play through. You don't want to be trying to come back and battling back, especially now that they're away for three games. They don't want to put themselves into that kind of position. They want to get out there, start scoring, converting early, but they're showing themselves to be more of a second-half team is what I've been noticing. They've just been a second-half team.
Scott didn't say anything
in the beginning, just at halftime.
The player that I think is most inconsistent in this game, I think is going to pretty much determine the series, is Dwayne Wade. He has played some of the most inconsistent basketball I've seen this playoffs in a long time. And I think it's mostly because his knee. I mean, he had his knee drained right before the last three games of the Pacers series, and he pretty much went off. And this series, it seems like after game one, he had a demeanor of like, don't tell me that I'm not trying, you know, this, that, and the other. And he kind of had this like kind of chin up sort of attitude. But after game two, he pretty much had like a more loose, like he was really, you know, at ease with himself. He was kind of joking, making cracking jokes with the media there and the presser. I just really can't figure him out. It seems like one game he has it all the way turned up and he's willing to, you know, go to the deck for whatever, for any loose ball. And other games, he's just really lethargic. Just not really, he's not into the game from the very beginning. I really can't put my finger on what it is, but I think he's going to determine the series. Because if he can get back to driving and attacking the hole, they're going to win this series. But if he wants to hang out and sort of just let the game come to him, they're going to lose.
I could be wrong, but I feel like the the criticism is starting to get to him. I think this is the most critical that the NBA or the critics have ever been to Dwayne Wade in his entire career. I mean, you know, literally people are saying that if Miami doesn't win this finals, it's no longer LeBron's fault. LeBron's been giving everything.
Oh, LeBron has been playing the best basketball I think we've seen in quite a while. I think it would be Dwayne Wade's fault if they lost the series.
I think that, you know, he's been able to kind of lean on the fact that if they don't perform, that LeBron's going to get the brunt of it. But now I think people are realizing, hey, man, you're the one that's not bringing your egg.
You keep on giving 30 a night, it's not your fault.
Yeah, no, exactly. It's not. And D-Wade is tasting a sliver of the pie
that LeBron
has had in his face.
Absolutely
for
right.
For years now. He's getting a sliver. So I don't want to hear about D-Wade's butt hurt about people criticizing him. If he's hurt, that's fine. Okay, you're hurt.
That was my point.
So put in. Get in where you fit
exactly.
In.
Exactly. This is game time. Do it. Go out there. That. Produce. This
I don't believe Bosh was hurt at all. There's no way that he comes back in those games.
That good?
And no extends way. It. It's not even
what's
about the play. It's
time
about
time
the
time
extension.
Out, time out, time out.
When you talk about the core, I mean, time I'm not trying to say he was faking, but a full strain? I'm sorry.
Yeah, it's a conspiracy.
What's the conspiracy?
Bosh was going to get over and scoring on that immediately.
So, wait, okay, Bosh was never hurt. That means Spoelstra is an idiot. Because it's one of the two. Either Spoelstra is a complete idiot and has no idea what the health of his player is on a day-to-day basis or how many minutes to play him, or he really is.
We know that
it.
Bosh is one for the dramatics. We saw him on his hands and knees after last call.
Chris Bosh loves attention.
The whole abdominal strain is a Hall of Fame flop to me. There's no way that if he did a full-blown abdominal strain like he said he did, that he comes back 2.5 weeks later and is jumping for rebounds and overextending himself, going for plays. There's no way you do that to your core muscle.
Let's not forget about the masseuse that fell dead working on that abdominal strain.
That is a little weird.
I did not approve that sound effect.
I agree that it's weird, though.
I think Bundy's is in a bottle over to Chris Bosh's cabana.
What, Jurgens?
Let's see where that goes. Oh, my goodness.
What, Jurgens?
I don't know about that.
We are talking after the next break. So okay.
We're going to the principal's office, man.
Ashy but classy, I'm talking
about. Hey now. All right, man. Well, we're talking about sending bottles over. If somebody sends a couple bottles over your way and you drink them all yourself, I want you to have this man's phone number in your phone, and that is H-Town's top DWI lawyer, and that is who? Rat Pack is in the building tonight because that was a nice Gary Tricker.
Yeah.
Yes, it is Gary
the luscious alcoholics in the
they all got his number in their phone. That's
shout
right.
Shout out to Gary Tricker.
Shout out to the man. And shout out.
The number one, Gary Tricker, number two on the speed dial.
He is number one in my book. That's for sure.
Talking
man.
To you, Ralph.
If you ride around it, if you ride around your trick room, as we say here at Sports Trap Live, make sure you guys have a non-drinking designated driver or take a cab or a limo, because both cost a lot less than having to call the man himself, Gary Trichter. But if you do decide to drink and drive, then you're going to have to follow the traffic laws religiously.
Tell me what we all do.
We all do the old two hands on the wheel, like, okay, is that light really green? Well, I see it's up.
When's the stop sign going to say go?
Exactly. And when it says go, use with precaution. Because if that cop pulls you over, he's going to start asking you questions. And you're going to have to ask for your lawyer. And he's going to not be very nice about that. So continue to be polite and ask for your lawyer, even if the officer says you can't have one. Because remember, you're likely going to be on video just like we all are here tonight on Sports Rap Live. Right here, shout out to Tripod. So continue to be polite because the DWI is going to cost you up to $12,000, a suspended license, a funny picture on the internet. I guarantee you an orange jumpsuit. Save yourself the headache, the hangover, and the money. Put this number in your phone. Do you have this number in your phone? Shout out to the ladies. The ladies, hey.
Y'all need it too because y'all
yeah,
need
absolutely. Absolutely. 713-524.
You want to see them on that video with their mascara running crying?
Okay. I only had two drinks. Yes, put this number in your phone, 713-524-1010. And if you want more information, visit TexasDWILaw.com. Here's a drink for you, Gary Trichter. All right, thank you. The wrap-up continues here, and the wrap sheet continues, brought to you by Active Athlete.
As we
resume the third quarter here.
We do. And it's 12 seconds in. But right now, before we get too much more in this game, because I know the executive producer is going to take his seat and watch the second half right here at Junction, let's talk a little bit about what we have on the table right here, Bun. We all saw the pictures coming out of OKC. We all heard the rumors. And this right here, this is something you're not going to see anywhere but right here on Sports Rap Live.
Well, I went to game one, of course, in Oklahoma. And while I was sitting there watching the game, I kept noticing this kid that was over with Wanda Pratt, and of course, Kevin Durant's mom and his whole, you know, the whole crew. And the kid had, of course, had on the crazy crazy Volt socks with these Volt KDs that I'd never seen before. I'd never seen any pictures of or anything.
And for those of you that don't know what Volt is, think fluorescent yellow, like bright.
Air Max.
Think Volt soda.
Yeah.
I mean, that should...
I've never heard of Volt soda. Do you watch NASCAR, dude? Anyway, Bun.
I have no idea where this conversation went. But so after the game, I saw the guy, and I walked up to him, and when I saw him, I realized it was Leo Chang, designer for Nike, who actually designed the KD4 Zoom shoe. And so naturally, I asked him if he wanted to trade shoes. I had on the Platinum Yeezys that night, and he was like, no, he didn't want to trade. But I became immediately infatuated with the shoe because of the fact that it was not available in stores. So I asked him if it was going to be a general release or one of the quick stripes or hypers. And he was like, no, this is a friends and family colorway anyway, you know, period. So it's only, you know, maybe 48 people, if that, that have these shoes. Fast forward to the next day, I find myself, I don't want this to sound a certain way, I find myself at Kevin Durant's house.
Hey, that's what Bunny does, right?
Yes.
Right?
At the studio, because Kevin Durant is actually doing some recording as well. So, you know, we're in the studio hanging out, and he, you know, everybody's like, you know, if you want something signed, let me know. I'm like, yeah, bring me a pair of shoes out the back. So they go and get two pair of shoes. They bring out the Art Pearl KDs, and they bring out this colorway. And I already got a pair of Art Pearls, even though they're not a size 18.
18, ladies and gentlemen.
That's a size canoe.
Size 18. That's a small forward right there.
Yeah, exactly. But being who I am and who I'm down with, and, you know, of course, naturally, I want the colorway that's totally unavailable. But I told him, you know, that the shoe's not for me. Like, I'm a fan, of course, but my wife, Queenie, if anybody knows, is a super fan of Kevin Durant and Oklahoma Thunder, to the point where it gets uncomfortable sometimes to watch your wife cheer, you know, so unabashedly for another
man. Just remember that he couldn't bench press not even 225 once in the combine whenever he was coming out.
You know, what am I going to do when he can?
I'm not sure he can still. I'm just saying you got some weight behind you.
He can get stronger. I can't get taller. So that's the dynamic that I'm looking
at. Okay, I have one question about his rapping ability. Does he have like a bass behind his voice?
He's not that light in the loafers on the voice.
No, I'm not saying that. But I mean, does he have like some oomph?
I mean, he's a young kid. He's getting there.
Will he sell
like
more than
everybody?
Artest, do you think he will sell more than Artest did?
I hope so.
I'm not gonna go there. That goes down to the music.
Yeah.
But you know, everybody can have a bad day. I've had bad days. But getting back to the shoe, I asked him to sign the shoe for my wife. He signed it for my wife. NiceKicks.com made a post. Kind of went out to a lot of the blogs, and the rest is kind of history. So now we're trying to dub this actual colorway the Queenie.
Wow.
So we've been referring to this shoe as the KD Zoom 4 Queenie colorway.
There it is.
So if it ever comes out as a general release in stores, we want people to refer to it as the Queenie.
I'm down for it.
You heard it right here on Sports Rap Live, ladies and gentlemen.
And you can see those on our Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter right now. This is what we in the sneaker world call a PE for short, a player exclusive, made exclusively for Kevin Durant, size 18 foot.
And we've had lots of PEs on the show as of late last couple months. So this is like... this is top of the line right now with what's going on right here on the court.
Hot fire.
Absolutely, because these are like game shoes. You know, we've had the Steve Nash game shoes in here before. I'm working on getting some Steven Jackson's and some Tony Parker game shoes. I was trying to get Tony Parker's All-Star shoe. He's just got to find it.
Hey, what about some Club-worn shoes?
See?
Hey, it's going to be hard to find that shoe with that scratch cornea.
Oh, wow.
Just saying.
There goes one of those Kadoma jokes.
Ricky Homer has brought me down to his level.
That's how bad it's called Kodoka.
Now I understand why the mic has been getting muted on this side of the table.
You've been out of town for a little bit. You've been out of town for a little bit. All right, well, let's continue. Before we get into the game itself and talk more about what's going into Game 3, don't forget to pick up the latest edition of Slam Magazine on newsstands right now with a cover story from a good friend from the program, Maurice Bob, as he graced his first cover with number one future draft pick Anthony Davis and the New Orleans Hornets jersey.
Is that out
swag.
Yet?
It's out.
Swag.
Because I went by the newsstand this week and tried to find it. It wasn't out yet.
It's starting to circulate. It hits people's mailboxes first.
I'm sure it's in the mailboxes in New York first and then everywhere else.
Well, hey, I'm going down to New Orleans this weekend. It better be there.
Oh, it better be.
It'll be on the newsstand.
It'll be in the airport when you
go. Absolutely. Yep, pick up one of those and a Maxim and you'll be good to go. All right, well, hey, we talked about it the other night a little bit, but each year this Thunder team seems to take the next step.
Right.
Okay. It started with the Lakers. We knew they had arrived, but they weren't at the lunch table, as Kobe famously said. Okay. Well, they ended up coming to the lunch table, and they stole the Lakers' lunch money. And the Dallas Mavericks, and the number one overall seed, San Antonio Spurs.
And you got to remember, until they played the Miami Heat in Game 2, they were undefeated at home in the playoffs.
9-0.
Very true. Very true. So, my question to you, Bud, I asked Courtney the question. Courtney Lee, of course, from the Rockets, joined us the other night. He also got his pair of Yeezys through Sports Drop Live. Laced him up. Is this team maybe not ready for this moment, but could be here for years to come?
Oh, no, this team is absolutely ready. I mean, they're physically capable. They're mentally capable. I think they got a competent coaching staff. It's just a matter of the right people taking the right advice. I think a lot of people have, you know, had a few issues with Westbrook playing. I mean, this guy shot 20 of 50 in the first two games. You know, that's abysmal. And, I mean, they're their worst.
How many assists? How many assists, Andrew?
I'm sure it's
I don't know how many assists, but it's, to me, he's playing like, you know, we talk about the bad Kobe, where he has to take such the high volume of shots to get his, you know, his numbers. And it's really about if he can work and get his teammates going, then whenever he wants his shot later on, that's when you want him to get, you know, get it going. It seems like that's what we're seeing. It's just like, I see that he has almost a triple-double, but I'm like, at what expense are the points coming for? I was watching game, I think it was 2, and at one point Kevin Durant was 4-for-4 in field goals in that quarter, and it makes you wonder, why is he not the first option every time down the court?
Why is he not 8-for-8 in the quarter?
I don't know if it's I wouldn't call it a God complex, but he definitely wants to be the hero. You know what I'm saying? Like, he wants to be the reason that they win. And, you know, that's fine. You can do that by assisting other players, you know what I'm saying, in scoring. You can do that by not taking the worst shots possible. I mean, his shot selection has just been just, I don't even know if there's
it's just volume. It's not efficiency. I mean, if he was a little more efficient with his game, I think it would do a wonder.
And it's not like he's just throwing the ball away and just constantly giving it over to the other team. His turnover ratio has not been crazy, but that's only because there's been some decent offensive rebounding.
Then he does stuff like that where he gets to the cup and he wraps it around and he makes the layup.
I have no problem with him driving. My problem is whenever he settles for jump shots.
Right.
When he starts settling for jump shots, then that's when I start to get angry because he doesn't shoot the high enough percentage.
And that's when Van Gundy makes comments like you heard earlier.
We heard Jeff Van Gundy on the broadcast today say he has already coached Westbrook back when his name was Steve Francis.
Oh, that's hilarious.
I can't believe you actually said that on air.
Yes, he did.
I mean, that's like a backhanded comment to Steve Francis and a front-handed slap to Russell Westbrook at the same time.
Yeah, I don't know who you're like, well, let's say, hey, whoa, hey, what? Yeah, you know how to take that.
Van Gundy, leave it to Van Gundy.
I didn't appreciate that. I'm a good friend with Maserati Steve, and I.
Well, yeah.
I think that's not that far removed though from the truth.
It is.
Well,
the truth kind of hurts sometimes.
It's really not that far removed from the truth. I mean, yeah, I would say Westbrook's a much better player than him, but
look, the beautiful thing
the volume of the shooting. I mean, that's pretty much what Steve Francis' deal is. He pretty much shot himself out of the NBA.
The beautiful thing about Stevie is that he wants the ball in his hands at any cost, and he wants to shoot the rock, and he'll take the three, he'll drive it to the bucket.
I think Westbrook's not always a good thing.
I know it's not, and that's why, love him to death, know him personally, but I mean. Uh-oh, because I was pointing at the sneaker commercial.
Finally, we get a Nike basketball commercial in the playoffs, the first one here in the finals, advertising the brand new Nike Plus 2012 Hyperdunk.
that you'll see in the Olympics.
Yeah, that works with your iPhone. It's got little sensors inside to help you jump and run and all that stuff do faster. But we'll talk about that on Thursday. Okay. All new Sneak of the Week, number 139.
A lot of the technology that's currently being displayed in the Nike Plus Fuel Band is what's going to be incorporated into these sneakers.
Into the sneaker itself. Here we are, 2015. Hello.
So that's coming on June 29th. So be looking for that. I'm definitely going to be trying to get a pair of those this week to try to have to show you guys in the next week or so before it releases.
One more question for you, Bud, before we get to this next break. This Oklahoma City team, no matter what they do, they win, lose, they're going to play till the buzzer sounds. We know that. We've seen that already.
Absolutely.
Their effort is there. Their crowd is behind them. Does this team find a way to keep James Harden and Serge Ibaka to keep this core together for the future? Or do you think because of the success already, this team could kind of start to take a different shape?
Well, I think James Harden has proven himself to be an incredible player and an incredible need for this team throughout the season. But you also see Serge Ibaka and, Steph Alosha really stepping it up in the playoffs. So I'm really curious as to who they would be looking forward to even getting rid of for next season. I mean, this is a very competent and very composed and a very solid team that they have right now. Their starting five is pretty solid. The sixth man off the bench.
They're still going to get back Eric Maynor, who I really wish he would have played this season. I think he had an ACL injury.
Exactly.
Yeah, so I really thought that he was going to be a really good backup point guard because he played last season, or not last season, but the season before. He really came on. I was disappointed he didn't get to play this year.
So I see them bringing back most of the principal players for this team next year.
Let me ask you this, Bun. Who is the sixth man of the year? Is it James Harden or is it Loud City?
I think that's a very good question. Loud City definitely supports this team to the fullest, game in and game out. They definitely help the players keep their energy up. But at the end of the day, they don't shoot one basket in the ring.
Those guys actually said that. They said that at a post-game press conference recently. Look, we love our crowd. Our crowd is what this city's all about. But in the end, we got to go out there and win the game. And they do it in game two.
But if you go to these games, I will say this. The dynamic between Harden and the crowd is a big factor. Because he's not only coming off the bench bringing energy to the court, he also brings energy to the crowd. And, you know, those guys are making plays when they're down a couple of points. Whether he's on the court or not, it's James Harden. James Harden is the guy that's bringing his hands up, telling, hey, come on, you guys, get high.
Not only on the hard court, but maybe in the club as well.
Okay, well, we'll get to that maybe later or not.
There you go. After the finals are over, we'll wrap up the entire thing, and we're going to wrap up the rest of all the sports talk here tonight on a Sunday night. Shout out Sunday. Shout out to the Rat Pack in the building. You guys are deep tonight. It seems like a Thursday almost, but that's how it is, man. When we have the games on, we got the cold drinks on deck, the hot ladies behind the bar, and once again, big shout out to Mrs. Rap. Happy birthday. She missed the intro segment. Well, I did shout her out. So once again, she is out there riding around and listening to Sports Rap Live like you can do on Sports Talk 790 AM and iHeartRadio. We'll be right back with the Soccer Talker right here on Sports Rap Live.
Wait a minute. Sports Rap Live will be right back.